The Assembly will now hear a statement by His Excellency the Prime Minister of Japan, Mr. Morihiro Hosokawa. May I request the Chief of Protocol to escort His Excellency, and I appeal for silence in the House. I have great pleasure in welcoming the Prime Minister of Japan, His Excellency Mr. Morihiro Hosokawa. I invite him now to address the General Assembly.
Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, ladies and gentlemen, I would like, first of all, to extend my heartfelt congratulations to you, Mr. President, who also served as Guyana's ambassador to Japan on an election last week to the presidency of this session of the General Assembly. Let me also express my deep appreciation to the previous president, Mr. Ganev, for this achievement during the past year, particularly in pursuing General Assembly reforms. I want to take this opportunity to commend Secretary General Boutros Ghali for his selfless devotion to the cause of global peace and for his bold efforts toward UN reform. And finally, I warmly welcome the representatives of the six new member states that have joined the United Nations over the past year. Mr. President, in Japan, the reins of government recently changed hands for the first time in 38 years. The coalition government that emerged has appointed me Prime Minister. Political changes in Japan are part of the dramatic changes in the international community since the end of the East-West confrontation. The post-Cold War era has opened not just a new page, but a whole new chapter in Japanese politics. This means an era of basic reform in three main areas, namely political, economic, and administrative reforms. I believe these reforms are vital in strengthening Japan's bonds with the international community. As I devote my attention and energy to these domestic reforms, I have come to the United Nations General Assembly on my first official visit abroad. I have done so because Japan believes that the United Nations has a crucial role to play in the maintenance of international peace and security. I also wished personally to convey Japan's determination to contribute both financially and in terms of personnel to various UN efforts. Further, I wish to state again that Japan continues to feel a sense of remorse over its past actions and that it is firmly resolved to make further contributions to the goals of world peace and prosperity. As for the current situation in Russia, Japan continues to support President Yeltsin in his reform efforts. Japan strongly hopes that a political environment which reflects the will of the Russian people will soon be created and that the reforms will be further promoted. Mr. President, today the primary objective of the United Nations and its member states is to establish world peace on the basis of the universal principles of freedom, democracy, and respect for human rights. There are four areas in which the international community must direct its greatest efforts in pursuit of this objective. I shall begin with the issue of disarmaments. The NPT is the centerpiece of efforts to prevent the spread of nuclear weapons. I wish to affirm that Japan supports the indefinite extension of the treaty beyond 1995. It is critically important that countries which have not yet acceded to the treaty will do so to enhance its universality. At the same time, the indefinite extension of the NPT should not mean to perpetuate the possession of nuclear weapons by the nuclear weapon states. Japan thus welcomes the progress made towards nuclear disarmament by the United States and Russia, and emphasizes that all nuclear weapon states must work in earnest to achieve further progress in nuclear disarmament. We hail the decision to commence substantive negotiations aimed at a comprehensive nuclear test ban. For its part, Japan will work actively to help reduce world stockpiles of nuclear weapons. For example, we are ready to assist in the dismantling of nuclear weapons in the former Soviet Union. We also strongly urge North Korea to dispel international concern about its development of nuclear weapons by, for example, fully implementing the safeguards agreement with the IAEA. On the transfer of conventional arms, the effective implementation of the UN Register of Conventional Arms is essential. I strongly urge all nations to participate in this endeavor. In extending its official development assistance, Japan continues to pay full attention to such trends as military expenditures in recipient nations. The second point I wish to make is the importance of diplomatic efforts in the prevention of conflicts. The value of regional security arrangements and bilateral or multilateral political and security dialogue is undeniable in preventing or settling armed conflicts. In this connection, I was deeply moved by and heartily welcome the historic signing of the Declaration of Principles of Palestinian Interim Self-Government by the Israelis and the Palestinians. I pay sincere tribute to the political leaders for taking this courageous step. It is essential that the international community supports this agreement actively and promptly in order to realize peace in the region. Japan will continue to play a constructive role in the multilateral negotiations that are part of the peace process. I am pleased on this occasion to announce Japan's intention to extend about $200 million in assistance to the Palestinians over the coming 2 years. This assistance will include grant aid for food and medicine and concessional loans for infrastructure. Humanitarian considerations, particularly respect for human rights, are inseparable from the issue of peace. Where there is war, human rights are often neglected. Conversely, in countries where respect for human rights has been firmly established, hostilities are less likely to break out. Japan must actively contribute to the solution of humanitarian problems. I would like to see my countrymen and women roll up their sleeves and work side by side with people from many other countries whenever and wherever humanitarian activities are called for. The third area of focus is economic development as a foundation for peace building. Today, the market economy has become become common language in most nations of the world, including many of the former socialist states. The development of the global economy based on principles of market economy should be urgently promoted. Japan and other industrialized nations must provide support to developing countries in their development efforts, as well as the former socialist countries in their political and economic reform efforts. It goes without saying that assistance to countries in transition must not come at the expense of aid to developing countries. Already, the world's top donor of official development assistance, in absolute terms, Japan recently established its fifth medium-term target to further expand such assistance. Japan intends to provide official development assistance totaling between $70 and $75 billion over the five-year period beginning 1993. As part of its aid efforts, 2 weeks ago, Japan hosted in Tokyo the third Mongolia Assistance Group meeting. Next week, in cooperation with the United Nations, we will hold the International Conference on African Development in Tokyo. The fourth item I would like to raise concerns global issues such as the environment and population. The urgent need to solve the problems of the global environment cannot be overemphasized. Japan is willing to assume a leading role in international efforts to tackle environmental problems. In so doing, we will draw upon the experience and know-how we have gained in overcoming serious pollution problems at home. Not only is Japan developing new technologies for environmental protection, it is taking the lead in transferring such technologies to developing countries through the International Environmental Technology Center of the UNEP, which was set up in Japan last year. At the 1992 UN Conference on Environment and Development, Japan pledged approximately $7 to $7.7 billion in environment-related official development assistance over the 5 years beginning 1992. In fact, Japan has already implemented more than one-fourth of that amount. Population problems are often a cause of poverty and famine. Solving these problems is therefore crucial to the goal of sustainable development and will require a broad-based approach, including education and public information efforts. With these thoughts in mind, Japan will sponsor a meeting of eminent persons on population and development next January, prior to the International Conference on Population and Development to be held in Cairo next year. Mr. President, the year 1995 will mark the 50th anniversary of the founding of the United Nations. Since the birth of this organization, immediately following World War II, the international climate has changed dramatically. In the meantime, the UN membership has grown from 51 states in 1945 to the present 184. Today, the international community is placing ever higher expectations on the United Nations. But serious reform efforts are necessary if the United Nations is to respond to these expectations and meet the new demands awaiting us at the threshold of the next century. I'd like to comment on these specific areas in which reforms are necessary, namely peacekeeping, the structure of the Security Council, and UN administration and finance. Last year, Japan enacted the International Peace Cooperation Law, enabling it to contribute personnel to UN peacekeeping operations. Since then, it has dispatched Japanese personnel to Angola, Cambodia, and Mozambique. Japan intends to continue to promote such cooperation in the future. Among the recent UN peacekeeping operations, the UN Transitional Authority in Cambodia stands out as a major achievement. I'd like to take this opportunity to express my deep respect for the efforts of UNTAC personnel and all the countries concerned. The success of the operation in Cambodia owes much to the comprehensive framework for peace that was put in place and the support it received from the international community. I'm convinced that its experience in Cambodia will provide the United Nations with useful insights for its future activities. Ensuring the security of the personnel engaged in UN peacekeeping operations is a task of high priority to the international community, and I hope this issue will be the subject of thorough debate in the current General Assembly. Other issues demanding our attention are the need to determine a so-called sunset for each peacekeeping operation, to evaluate each operation properly, to review strictly the activities of an existing operation in deciding further to extend its mandate. Japan also strongly hopes that a peacekeeping reserve fund, which was established last year, will be fully funded and used effectively. The sharp increase in the number of regional conflicts has meant a dramatic expansion of the role of the Security Council. Accordingly, it is necessary that the functions of the Council, which has primary responsibility for maintaining international peace and security, be strengthened. It is important that those countries having both the will and the adequate capacity to contribute to world prosperity and stability be actively engaged in that effort. The views submitted by many member states, including our own, in response to a General Assembly resolution on the subject last year, generally indicate the need to expand the membership of the Security Council while ensuring that its effectiveness is maintained. Japan intends to participate constructively in the discussion on Security Council reform. Today, the United Nations finds itself in extremely serious financial straits. In particular, the rapid expansion of peacekeeping operations has made it increasingly difficult for this organization to meet its financial needs promptly. Without adequate financial resources, the United Nations would be powerless to engage in any activity, no matter how meaningful it may be. I would like to remind all UN member states of how important it is that they face this reality and fulfill their obligations. At the same time, I note with concern the frequent allegations of inefficiency, of wastefulness at the United Nations. I hope the United Nations will make utmost efforts to meet the need for greater financial discipline and effective budgetary control. Japan is prepared to do all it can to discharge its responsibilities in the United Nations, reformed with the previous 3 points taken into account. Mr. President, when the UN's forerunner, the League of Nations, was established in 1920, the renowned Japanese educator, Dr. Inazo Nitobe, was appointed as one of its deputy secretaries general. Dr. Nitobe had sought to introduce Japan's philosophical traditions to the world and remarked that the Japanese place great value on moral principles. I would like to conclude my address by offering a quote from one of Dr. Nitobe's lectures, which reflects my own view on the evolving bonds between Japan and the international community. An international mind is not the antonym of a national mind. The international mind is an expansion of the national, just as philanthropy or charity should begin at home. Thank you.
On behalf of the General Assembly, I wish to thank His Excellency the Prime Minister of Japan for the statement he has just made, and I ask the Chief of Protocol to escort His Excellency from the podium.